If you have any further questions, please let me know.
You silly goose.
Tell him what you think.
I know math. I know reading.
Give him some tips.
Okay.
Be a businessman.
So this is how you count by two. But I don't know how to count by twos, but I do know how to count by twos to 10.
Let's see it.
2, 4, 6, 8, 10.
What? That's amazing.
And this is how you count by 1 to 100.
Okay. All right, we're going to talk about how to balance work and family. This is not scripted because this isn't a topic that I think I'm that great at. I've had a lot of people in the group consistently ask me, how do you balance family and work? So I'm going to give you 8 tips that my wife and I have done in our 7-8 years of entrepreneurship. Things we've learned, both good and bad, to have a better balance with our family. And I consulted my wife on these 8 tips because it's kind of a family dynamic. It's not just what I'm doing, it's what we are doing together. And that's probably the biggest tip, is that you have to communicate with your significant other, your spouse, and come up with, what is our balance? How are we going to do this together? Because it's not just you, it's a family matter. So the first tip I'll give is to have a clearly defined schedule. Separate your work hours from your family hours. Now, this is really hard to do as an entrepreneur because you're pretty much always on. If there's a pressing email that comes in or employees that need something, you kind of always have to be on call. And that's just kind of the nature of the beast, is realizing even if you have a schedule, sometimes you're going to go outside of it. However, in the beginning with my wife, it was kind of like, okay, I'm going to get up at 7. I'm going to work from then all the way until 6. And then I'm going to eat dinner with you. We're going to hang out for a few hours. And then I'd go back to work from like 10 p.m. to 1 in the morning, and then we do it all over again. That was the grind for me at the very beginning of our marriage. And we had made a pact early on and said, hey, we're going to dedicate more hours than normal. I'm going to work 16-hour days to try and build this business, which is full-time filmmaker, what you're watching now. And I told my wife at that time, I said, look, I can work a 9-to-5. However, I think I have what it takes to build something great. However, that means you and I are going to have to sacrifice some of this time in the early years of our marriage, not going to be able to go on as many vacations, not going to be able to have as much time together, because we're going to live like nobody's willing to now so that we can live like nobody can later on. So that was my pitch to her, and she was fully on board. She said, I want you to be happy. I think you're going to be most happy if you pursue this. So we did that together. We made that commitment together that we were going to have less time than normal. That having been said, early on, we did not do a good job at scheduling out, separating work from family time. Now, luckily at the time, we didn't have kids, and so it was less demanding, and my wife was able to latch on to her family, her siblings, her mom and dad, so that when I wasn't as available, she just kind of reverted back to being a daughter of her family. But as we started having kids, this became trickier. We realized pretty quick that we're going to have to separate the two, because I'd get off work at 6, and then I'd come and hang out with the family, but I'd be on my phone, I'd be checking emails and catching up on some personal stuff because I was so consumed in work. Once they'd go down to bed, I'd go back downstairs because I worked from home, and I'd be editing until midnight. And my wife finally said, look, this isn't it. Like, we need to have you 100% you when you're with us. And that's the second tip, is to be 100% where you are when you're there. So scheduling for us, it was 8 to 6 was my work hours once we got into more of a normal groove. And then from 6 on, no work. Computer's off, phone is off. We are not going back to work the rest of the night. Again, sometimes stuff comes up, you have to take emergency calls, whatever, but that's the exception, not the rule. 95% of the time, from 6 on, you are with the family. That is our schedule. Having that schedule really allowed us as a family to know that, okay, from 6 on, I know that Parker is going to be here with the kids, with me 100%. And then from 8 to 6, she knows that's sacred time for me to be in the zone, in the momentum zone. We talk about that in the time management video, being in deep work, allowing me not to be distracted, because again, I worked from home at the time. And if kids and mom are coming in and out, asking me to help out and tend and whatever, then I can't get my work done. But then vice versa, if I'm doing work while we're with family, then they're not getting the quality time they need. So be 100% where you are when you're there. Don't be distracted on your phone, both at work and at home. If you're at work, it's a temptation to jump on here and start scrolling through Instagram and look at some TikToks and watch some videos on YouTube. Oh, that new camera came out. Let's check. Unless your job is to review cameras, don't spend work time looking at some new cameras, or unless you're looking to make a big investment, then sure. But if it's just browsing for fun, ooh, a new camera, let's go check that out. You need to limit yourself to those distractions. I highly recommend that you turn off all the notifications on your phone, including email, including social media, even text messages. I have turned to silent. Phone calls is about the only thing that I'll get notified of, but I've been very clear with the people in my life who have that phone number. Please do not call me during work hours unless you really need my time. So that I know that if someone calls me, oh, I probably should pick this up because it must be important. That's a hard thing for a lot of people, is to turn off those notifications. It's so fun when you get that ding that somebody liked your Instagram. You guys, such a waste of your life and time. Please turn off your notifications. Be deep in your work when you're working. Be deep in your family when you're with your family. Eliminate the distractions. That's one of the hardest things for me and that I struggle with when I get off work, is putting the phone away, because I'm usually deep in work. And then when I get off work, I'm like, oh, now I want to catch up on Instagram and look at some texts that people sent me. Oh, and it's not even necessarily bad things. It's like, oh, my mom needs something from me. So I sit here and I'm texting my mom, and my wife's like, hello, we're over here. So you may need to even schedule in some personal time, which is tip number 3. Schedule in personal time as well in the mix of that family and work time. At some point, you're going to do something for yourself. And it's either going to crop up during work time or it's going to crop up during family time. So I personally like to have an hour dedicated to the day where I go work out, and that's my me time. But have a time that's some you time that allows you to kind of decompress, because when you go just from 8 hours of work, 9 hours of work to, all right, now I got to be with the kids and be engaged, it's hard to be 100% all day long, 16, 18 hours like that. So having an hour of the day that you dedicate to yourself to re-energize and have some personal time, I think, is very important as well. On that note, our next tip is to stay healthy. You're just being a victim if you say that, oh, I'm working so hard and I have no energy, but you're eating Doritos and Oreos for lunch and you're not allowing yourself to get enough sleep and you're not exercising, so you have no energy. No one's gonna feel bad for you for not having energy when you're not doing the things that create energy outside of working really hard and being with your family really hard. You have to be able to take care of yourself. So that goes into that personal time dynamic, taking that time to be healthy, and not just physically. It is important to get enough sleep. It is important to eat well, have a good breakfast that's going to give you energy, cut down on the amount of sugar you're taking, drink a lot of water. I mean, these are some basic health tips I could go on, but you know, exercise daily, get your endorphins flowing, get your blood moving. All these things are going to create more energy and make you a more functional, my wife calls it the asset. She says, you are the asset in your business. You, your body, your mind, that is your asset. That's the most important thing that's going to help your business flourish. And if you're not taking care of it, like if your car was your asset to your business, wouldn't you make sure it's well oiled and taken care of and that nothing's wrong, so that when you go to work, the car's working properly? Well, same thing with your body. Take care of it. Make sure it's in prime condition every day. And again, not just physically, but spiritually. Take time within your religion. Don't neglect that, so that you are in a good spiritual state emotionally as well, so that you're not depressed or anxious. That's also going to dip in to both family and work time. So you are the asset. Take care of your health in all regards, and it's going to allow your business to flourish, and it's going to allow you to do better at both work and at home. Next tip is to cut out the fluff. We have more time than we realize. That's one of the biggest complaints I always hear is, well, there's just not enough hours in the day. And it's like, yeah, I feel that. I can definitely resonate with that. However, if you take inventory, and you should, of where you're spending your time, clock in and out. Every time you get on Instagram, start a timer. Just have a timer with you. I'm like, all right, let's see how long I spent on Instagram. You will be shocked how much time you can save in your day if you cut out the fluff. the stuff that's just not productive, not necessary, not even helping you re-energize. Because that is something that I teach in time management, is to take time for yourself to re-energize. But when I say that, I'm talking about things that actually bring you more energy. Fueling yourself with food, going and working out, getting your endorphins pumping, taking some time to meditate or read your scriptures, if that's what you do for your spiritual health. That's the kind of stuff that's going to re-energize you. Not scrolling on Instagram and TikTok, that doesn't re-energize. That's just vegging, and that's just further going to waste energy on something that isn't helpful. And that's a hard thing for someone who's gone from maybe being single and having all the time in the world to now having a wife. And now, okay, now your time's 50-50. Then you have a kid. Now you have 30% of your time to yourself. Pretty soon you have four kids and your time just whittles down more and more. And you realize, okay, I got to cut something out. I either got to cut out my kids or I got to cut out some of the crap that is just wasting my time. Take inventory of everything you're doing in that day and decide, all right, what can I cut out of my life that just isn't as important as my work and my family. Next tip is quality over quantity. Talked about scheduling out your time. I would argue that if you have scheduled 4 hours of time with your children, that if it's 4 hours of you popping on and off phone calls and checking texts and looking at something on Instagram, 4 hours of that versus 1 hour of intense, focused, dedicated, intentional time with your children, that 1 hour is going to be way more valuable to them than the 4 hours of you kind of in and out and that's cool, you physically being there isn't the point. It's you being there completely emotionally, mentally, physically, everything. Having that quality time is way more important than just quantity. So if you're in the grind, which a lot of you may be in your business, recognize that it's okay to maybe only have 1 or 2 hours where you're going to be able to dedicate to your children or to your spouse because you're in a grind moment. But make that 1 or 2 hours very quality. And then when you do start having more hours, when you're less in the grind, even then, it's important to not just say, oh, well, I was home all day. Saturday, I was with the kids all day. It's like, okay, but how much of it, my wife calls it special time, where she'll take one of the children. We have 3 kids now. She'll take one of the kids and she'll say, all right, the next 15 minutes is our special time. Just you and me. My phone's not here. Even the other kids aren't here. It's just our one-on-one time. And we are going to focus on each other. And I'm going to show you that I intentionally love you and want to be with you. Even if it's 15 minutes a day, make special time for every one, you know, each of the kids and your spouse without distraction. It's intentional and it's quality. All right, next tip is to communicate with your spouse. Make sure you run all of this stuff by her. Make sure you guys talk about all the things you're trying to do with this balance and make sure you let her know, this is a tip my wife gave me to give you, is because sometimes I'll get backed up on work and I'll need to work overtime and she can tell something's bothering me and, you know, I'm checking my phone and I'm anxious and I'm distracted and whatever else. Just communicate with her. Say, look, honey, I know we have our set schedule, but today something happened at work and I need to take an extra couple hours tonight. Are you okay taking the kids? We're going to ruin our schedule tonight, but I really need to take care of this. Communicate that stuff with her. Because I was trying to keep the schedule, I would just get off, but then I'd be thinking about work all day and I wasn't intentional and I wasn't having quality time. I was physically there, but I was still at work. Sometimes there's going to be things that come up that are going to require you to have to work overtime, but communicate those things with your wife. Because what would happen with my wife is she'd say, I could tell you were in a bad mood and I thought it was because of me. I took it personal, and women do that. They think if you're in a bad mood, it must be because I don't look beautiful today, or he's not pleased with something. And then they start getting self-conscious and then they start withdrawing and then you start withdrawing. And then it creates this terrible dynamic that could have been avoided if you just communicate and said, hey, look, I'm very stressed. I would like to take an extra hour of work. Is that okay with you? Communicate that stuff, and that's going to go a long ways from creating rifts that could last days or weeks when they could be avoided with some communication. And the last tip I have to give you about balancing work and family is that you can't. You cannot perfectly balance work and family. By definition, if you are with your family, you're neglecting work. And if you're at work, you are neglecting your family. It's impossible to keep both perfectly balanced all the time. The key should be keeping the plate spinning, and I'm going to show you an example after this video from one of my church leaders, Elder Bednar, who basically says it's like those trapeze artists who have all the plates spinning. You can't keep all of them spinning at exactly the same speed at exactly the same time. There's always going to be one that's about to fall, but do your best to keep all of them at least moving. If one falls off, that's when you know you've neglected it and you've gone too long without giving that one a spin. So perfect balance, it's unachievable, but try your best to give enough time and attention often enough, quality enough, so that every aspect of your life is at least afloat. Perfectly balanced, not gonna happen. Functional and working and enough, possible. So that's my tips, guys, for how to balance work and family. Again, I'm not a pro at this. These are just some of the things that my wife and I have learned together after 8 years now of entrepreneurship, and it's something that I still haven't mastered. That's why I've been hesitant to even give my input, because these tips that I give you, I still mess up with them all the time. And so that's another tip, is just don't be too hard on yourself. Don't beat yourself up. Don't worry about it too much. Just make sure that you're always trying to improve and correcting when you're imbalanced in one area, because you're always going to be imbalanced in one area. So that's all I got on this topic. Hopefully that was helpful to some of you. We will now cut to Elder Bednar, and you can see this fun example that really hits home that last point I just gave you. That's all I got. If you have any further questions, please let me know.
You're a young man with significant responsibility in your home, in the church, and at work. How do you do it all? Yeah, you can. So don't worry about it.
Así que no se preocupe.
Balance is a false notion. You can only do one thing at one time. So if you're attending to your family, by definition, you are neglecting church and work. If you are at work, by definition, you cannot attend to the immediate needs of your family or church. So when you're home, be home. Not at work, not at church. When you're home, be home. When you're at church, be at church. Not at home, not at work, at church. When you're at work, be at work. Not at church, not at home, at work. Many men, when they're at home, are at church, especially obese folks, because the phone rings all the time. But do your best, okay? Now, balance is like a Chinese acrobat. Have you seen this? You know what I'm talking about. So you spin the plate, but now I have to spin this plate. Then I spin this plate. That's life. Can you get the three plates spinning at exactly the same speed at exactly the same time? Nope. One is always closer to falling off, and you have to hurry and get to that one and spin it. Now, there's a lesson from that illustration. There's an optimum number of plates that each of us can spin. It's probably the case that you cannot spin 17 plates. So with the help of the Holy Ghost, and especially from our wives, we can identify the 2, 3, 4 most important plates that always need to be spun. Now, over time, we simply make sure that none of the plates fall off and break. Let me give a personal example. I was a young stake president. Our children were small, and the stake over which I presided was very large geographically. 500 kilometers north and south, 500 kilometers east and west, 17 units, 9 branches and 8 wards. If you want me to feel sorry for you because of the distances that you travel, you're talking to the wrong apostle. There were some units that were so far away, I had to leave Saturday afternoon and travel part way in order to be there Sunday morning. I remember on some days, one of my sons, as I was getting ready to go out the door, he'd say, "Daddy, can you play with me now?" Now, you can drive yourself crazy with that question. Sometimes I had to tell him, "No, I can't. Heavenly Father has given me a responsibility, and I have to leave now to be able to do that. So though I want to play with you, I need to leave now." That's one episode. If my answer is always no, the plate does not get a spin and it falls off and breaks. Sometimes I would be going to leave and he would say, "Daddy, can you play with me now?" I'd say, "Yes, I need to leave, but let's play for a while first." And I may have to be late to something that I was supposed to do as a stake president. Over time, it's good for that little boy to hear both no and yes for an answer. He knows I love him and he knows I love the Lord. And in any one episode, don't worry about it too much. Just make sure over time, the plate gets a spin and it doesn't fall off and break.